Please stand with me as we sing the National Negro Anthem. Lift every voice and sing.
First Congregational Church of Los Angeles. It is our joy and our pleasure for you to be in this sacred space tonight. It has been our dream for a long time that the performing arts would come into this space and that together with spirituality and justice, we would work together for a future that is broad and welcome, that is inclusive and expansive. Tonight, I personally am looking very forward to this concert. I sit in that chair every Sunday from 10:30 to 12:30, but I never really get to enjoy it. So tonight, this is a gift for me personally to be able to sit and to enjoy this music. We thank you for being with us and for honoring us. Let us pray. Everlasting God, your goodness and your love for us has come from the beginning and will travel with us until the end. We pray in this time that we will open our hearts and our minds to the melodies that will soothe our souls. We pray, God, for this world that needs peace in all places. And we pray that as we spend this time together, we will once again remember that we are your beloved children. We ask this all in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Well, I appreciate you being here. You've got a challenge in the second half.
All right, well, I know you will.
All right, do my best.
Yeah.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I know you've had a wonderful time this evening. And the Afro-American Chamber Music Society Orchestra presents, of course, the Gospel Blues, the masterpieces of Mr. Derek Skye, right here at First Congregational Church of Los Angeles. And my, what a very beautiful church. Can we have a round of applause for God's creation? And ladies and gentlemen, now I'd like to introduce to you Mr. Derek Skye. How are you, Derek?
Doing well. Thank you.
Great meeting you here, and it's a lovely evening. We're very excited about your music. The first thing I'd like you to tell us about your music, it's in rhythm and it's in all cultures. And how do you create the music as a composer? Because we also know that you're a musician and that you're an educator also.
Yes, that's right. So I also, well, because I'm also a musician, I love to play. And a lot of the cultures that I have in my musical language come from me learning how to play as many different approaches to music making as possible. And I continue to do that today, so.
And you play trombone.
I play trombone,
and
yes.
Percussion.
And percussion, that's right.
So it's quite a combination.
Yes.
The LA Times had a wonderful statement about Mr. Derek Skye. They said, something to savor, an enormous fun to listen to. Now that sounds very interesting when it says enormous fun. Explain.
Well, I often like to make music that makes people want to dance or groove or just kind of flow with the beat. And so I think that's probably where that comes from, because it's a very kind of on the edge of your seat kind of a scenario with my work, as I'm sure you guys all know.
I would say you're the new vision revolutionary of blues classical music, which tonight we get a chance to hear some blues classical symphonic music, if you will. Explain.
So a lot of my music takes root in improvisation. It's the improvisation is kind of the foundation of a lot of the music that I write. And one of the biggest challenges with improvisation is when the player is the player's relationship to music making and improvisation, whether or not they're plugged into the kind of improvisation that's going to resonate with any specific individual at any time. And so what I like to do is kind of take what my rendition is of improvisation personally and notate it all out. So that others can kind of get into the kind of improvisation that I'm looking for, which is a very kind of cross-cultural improvisation, where you hear some blues, you hear some Eastern European music, you hear some North African, West African music, and you kind of hear it all tied up and interwoven together in kind of single lines. So, yeah, so.
Well, you're a very busy young man. You're the artistic director of the Chamber Ensemble and the artistic organization. It says Bridge to Everywhere. I like that. Bridge to Everywhere. What are your thoughts on that statement?
I love it.
I knew you were.
Yeah, we were, my ensemble Bridge to Everywhere, we recently did a show in Beverly Hills on Thursday night, and our approach to music making is much like some of what my compositions are, where we like to make pieces that are essentially cross-cultural classical music. And so there's elements of improvisation, there's elements of jazz, there's many, many different kind of cultural approaches to music making that we have. And our entire set of music that we often play is all pieces written by the composers themselves, because you can't always find music that approaches music making in this way, and so we end up having to make a lot of it for ourselves to play.
I know that you're a teacher in Los Angeles Philharmonic, and that you also conduct for the Santa Clarita Orchestra, if you will, and the Value Youth Orchestra. You are very busy. When you're doing this, are you incorporating your new thoughts in your music with these young people?
Oh, yes, all the time. Yeah, all the time. I really want young people, specifically young people that are growing up in classical music, to know that every culture has their form of classical music, and all of the classical music across the entire spectrum of humanity has similarities and can work together quite nicely. And so keeping them kind of open really kind of sets the tone for a very holistic education in music making.
This audience, thank you very much, sir. This audience knows about classical music, gospel music, and all realms of music. But in today, when we think about music, it certainly has, you know, we have rap, we have country, we have hard metal, and there are new genres trying to incorporate with symphonic music. If you would explain that.
Yes, so there's always been a desire for everyone to work together. And I think, sometimes people don't do that very well, and then other times people do, but I think that that's also like a hope that everybody has across humanity is, can we all work together and how can we do that? And so that simple philosophy translates very well into artistic practice as well, to the point where artists, including musicians, are always looking for new ways to combine things and overlap things, and out of that comes new voices. This is it's something that's been going on for 50,000 years of human history, and people, the emergence of different ways of specifically with music making, so we're kind of continuing on that tradition, although it's a little bit harder with the kind of models that we have now of how we've, you know, divided up society. But nonetheless, people have a desire to find ways to work together.
Obviously, we're in the house of God, and one of the great things when we deal with God, when we deal with Jesus Christ, we deal with rejoicing, with singing, with music. And do you see your music being incorporated into Christianity in churches?
Actually, it has been. My choral pieces have found their way into the church. And my family is a huge fan of the church. And there they are over there. And they're very comfortable in those pews. Yeah. So I grew up in the church. And so I'm very familiar with the church and the tradition, and that's actually was the biggest inspiration for my music, was, you know, going to church hearing orchestras, hearing choirs, and, you know, observing the playing styles of everybody that came to visit, and, you know, wanting to be a part of it.
This is a very heavy question, but it's a question we all get asked. In our busy society, in our troubling society, how do you handle the stress? And how did God come into that to help you handle that and handle peace itself within yourself?
Yeah, so there's a lot going on right now all over the world. And I think that for me, I'm always looking for the reason why. Why am I doing what I'm doing? And how is that contributing to the conversation in any way? And a lot of times when I think about these things, I think about, you know, well, what's the purpose of us playing music, the pieces that were played before, or any pieces in general? And one of the things that always comes up, that continues to like kind of pop into my head, is the idea that as musicians, we are the keeper of the sound of a culture, right? And so the fight that we have is to preserve the sound of a culture and continue that, because you can't necessarily write down a sound. You have to hear it. Somebody has to play it. And so that's our purpose. So whenever there's a war going on, whenever there's this kind of chaos where one group of people is trying to eliminate another, they're also trying to eliminate the sound of that culture. And the best thing that we can do is to play the sound of that culture and keep it alive, keep it going.
We have some young people here today from the Unified School District, and they have some questions, and this first young gentleman probably would like to ask that question. Come on.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask, what are some things that have really inspired you over your life as someone who grew up listening to people like John Williams, Count Basie, a lot of people like that. What different composers or specific pieces have really inspired you?
That's a really good question. So the inspiration comes from collections of composers and pieces. So the reason why I write music, period, is because I'm always wanting to hear something that I can't find. And so if I can't find somebody else that's done this, because I just want to hear it, then I'm going to write it and figure it out that way, and then listen to it because I just want to hear this thing. And so what I would be thinking is with your example, here's John Williams, who I love. Here's Count Basie. Now, where's that combination of John Williams and Count Basie? And then I can't find it, so then I'm going to go and I'm going to do it because I want to hear that combo, right? So that's where my inspiration comes from, is having all of this collection of composers and these collections of pieces and sounds, and saying, wow, that part's really cool, or this is, oh my gosh, how did they come up with that? Now what if we take that, move it over here, and do all this stuff, and then like this kind of different voice emerges, right? So yeah, I hope that answers the question.
Yeah.
By the way, what school do you come from?
Fauché Learning Center.
Okay. Wonderful, thank you very much. And what is your question that you'd like to ask Derek Sky?
My question is, what do you think is the most meaningful piece you've composed and why?
The most meaningful piece I've composed, oh my goodness. I don't know, I like them all. Usually I'm in love with the most recent one because it's new. There's a piece called American Mirror that I wrote, and it was the first piece in which I feel like I was able to zoom in on the kind of voice that I really wanted to have as a composer. I was very afraid of the notation for that piece, as with the notation for As I Heard When I Was Young, because I thought that I wasn't supposed to do that. But then after studying scores of like Ligeti and Penderecki, I figured, oh, well, shouldn't be a problem with me doing what I'm gonna do. So I'd say that piece is probably the most meaningful. And it was just it was just a moment where I felt comfortable writing the way that I wanted to write. That was the first piece in which that kind of happened. Yeah.
And your name?
Michelle.
And Michelle, what school are you from?
Fauché Learning Center.
The louder?
Fauché Learning Center.
Thank you very much. You know, the future is our children, and we want them to be in the right direction with the right education. It's so important, and music is part of that. Yes, dear.
So my question was more specific to the piece. Madison and I actually got to listen to the rehearsal on this piece on Thursday, and I noticed there's kind of like a constant rhythm, like ostinato rhythm throughout it. I was just wondering if you could have like someone demonstrate it possibly and like tell us where that rhythm came from or like the inspiration for it.
Yeah, sure. Here, I'll do it. You hold it.
Okay.
So that's that rhythm. And that rhythm is one of my favorite rhythms in history because it can be divided into multiple ways. It can be 7 + 5, you can hear it in 3, you can hear it in 4, and you can hear it in 2. And so because it has those three divisions, then everything that I write throughout the piece is emphasizing those different pulses. And then that's also something that you can find. And this piece is heavily influenced by West African music. And you can find that scenario in there where it's like a Rubik's Cube, where there's that single rhythm, and every time the emphasis changes, it still fits in that pocket, but it gives you a different view, which is why it's called Prism Cycles Leaps, because you can look at the same thing, and then you can just turn it, and it looks different, but it's the same thing, yeah.
By the way, what school are you from? I'm sorry.
I go to UCLA.
UCLA. Yep. Great school for music.
Yes, it is.
And your name?
My name's Emma Lumsden.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Madison. I go to UCLA as well. Just to kind of close the kids out questions and stuff like that, I wanted to know if you have any advice for the future generations of composers or composers at heart and stuff like that, and what would be your biggest takeaway when creating that music? So, yeah.
So the biggest rule is that there's no rules when you get out, and
I respect that.
Yeah, and I think that sometimes when we're studying very specific things with our music education, the kinds of music education that's available, is we have to understand that particular approach to music, that language of music, is only one part of a larger language that that the whole world speaks. And walking out of those doors, remembering that, okay, well, I just got that little piece, and so now I've got to go get the rest, and then you can spend the rest of your life getting the rest of it, like me. But it's a fun process, and you meet a lot of people on the way, and that's what I think that's what really energizes long-lasting creativity, is just continuously encountering new experiences with new people and new practices.
And your name and school?
Madison, UCLA.
Thank you, Madison.
No problem.
Well, as we leave on this particular interview so that we can hear the second part of your wonderful music, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention this. And that is, do you feel that the creation of music, especially the music you're creating, will help to afford peace? We know true peace comes with our relationship with Jesus Christ. But we also know that music soothes the soul. So there are people throughout history, and you're one of the newcomers coming in for the new generation. So your thoughts on that?
It is my hope that it does. Sometimes I think about music like I think about food. Like when you encounter a different culture's way of making a meal, and you sit down and you can start getting all those tastes in your mouth, like it could make you feel a lot better about that culture because the food tastes great. And so I feel like the music kind of works the same way, where people can kind of get this sound and like, wow, I kind of hear this groove and I kind of like this, and it reminds me of this, or it reminds me of that. Oh, have you ever heard this one thing? Yeah, I've heard that. Oh, well, then we can have a conversation together, you know? So whatever I can do to kind of build more opportunities for people to have a conversation about something they have in common together, then that's what I'm gonna do. And that's what I mean, that's what the diplomats do when they're trying to stop a war. They're like, okay, look, we have this in common, you have that in common, so we both want the same thing. So maybe we shouldn't do this, and we should go do that instead. So it's kind of, I kind of see that approach to community as being something that goes all the way up and down the lines of power, whether you're with us here or, you know, leading a government somewhere. That's that seems to be the strategy.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Derek Sky. One message to you all, and thank you so much, Derek, and that is keep your visions positive. Keep positive people around you, and know that God is there to guide you along the way. Thank you. I'm Pete Allman.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Before we go, can we have everyone seated? May we have everyone seated? I would like to call Derek Sky to the front of the sanctuary so we can present a beautiful commendation, which has been signed by City Councilman Marquis.
You need a mic.
You take a picture. Go ahead. Come on. I'm going to call up Derek Sky, this phenomenal composer of less than 40 years old.
Yeah.
Woo! His music has been performed, as you saw in the program notes, all over the world. And we are just so honored that he is so humble to play, to actually be here in our presence as we, as we present his music. Okay, now you can hear me. All right. Start again. You know, we are so honored to have Derek Sky in our midst tonight. He is a humble person, sweet demeanor, and he was always willing to answer our questions that we had about his music. And even though he is world-renowned and less than 40 years old, young, he is here. And we appreciate you so much. And thank you, Vince, for introducing him to us. He said he would bring in young phenoms, and that's what he has. So, Vince, come on over. And I want to also recognize Derek Sky's parents, if they're here. Would you stand, please? Would you take a picture? Now, who are we looking at? Who are we seeing? Oh, wonderful. Oh, okay, can we have you come up? And we want to present to you on behalf of Councilman of the 8th District, Marquis Harris Dawson, this beautiful, beautiful commendation. If you look closely at the very bottom of the commendation, you will see that it is signed by every one of the council members, city council members of Los Angeles. And let me just read what it says. Certificate of recognition is hereby presented to Derek Sky, the masterpieces of Sky Gala. The City of Los Angeles and Council District 8 join in recognizing Derek Sky, a phenomenally gifted young and emerging African-American composer. Derek has been enhancing the symphony orchestras in the city of Los Angeles and nationwide with his culturally innovative music, including the Los Angeles Chamber Orchestra, the Albany Symphony, Berkeley Symphony, the National Orchestra Institute, and Lian Ensemble, just to name a few. And let's not leave out what the Netherlands Symphony, the Juilliard School, now what were the others? Some of the heavies. And his music has already been performed in Carnegie Hall, I believe the Kennedy Center,
Walt Disney Hall,
that's local. He's not even 40. All right. Take a bow. Derek has received countless commissions by major symphony orchestras and is the recipient of the 2021 Princess Grace Award. Thank you for all that you do and best wishes in your future endeavors. To our audience, thank you so very much for supporting the Afro-American Chamber Music Society Orchestra in our endeavors to preserve the music of Black symphonists. We began this journey sometime in 1989. We actually made our debut performance over KUSC Radio for Sundays Live, and it lasted until 2015. And so we're very proud of our success. Our music is played over the BBC radio. It's archived in the British Library. And we're just very, very pleased that you thought enough of Black symphonists to come and enjoy the works that we have created. Thank you. Outside, in the back, I see our president, Liz White. Just wave. And she's another very committed and dedicated supporter. I want you to know that outside, we have recordings that you can purchase. And look in your program, you will see upcoming concerts as well. I want to thank everyone, all of the orchestra musicians, and I want to thank Cleveland, Stand Up Cleveland. She's our secretary treasurer. She's been running all over the place, trying to make sure we have what we need. And our volunteers, I think Ben White, are you here? Ben White, my brother, way up there in the back. Okay, you probably saw him at the ticketing table, and his wife, and Antoinette, are you here? Antoinette was also working. So all those people who work behind the scenes and those who prepare for the music and those who compose the music. Thank you very much. And our audience, thank you more for being here. And the orchestra, yes. Okay, so we'll see you in May here. We'll see you in April at the Crenshaw United Methodist Church. Have a look at your program and continue to support Black Symphonists. Thank you very much. And thank you, Pete, with Celebrity News. Thank you. And the pastor.